All right, so one of the things that we really want to start engaging with the community is really shifting the mindset of how we think of Alzheimer's and dementia. One of the things that really drove me to this program was the thought process that we really need to look at the individuals as a person and all of their abilities that they have. I started my healthcare career as a naive 19-year-old in adult foster care home. And I worked with individuals with developmental disabilities. And these individuals, for their entire life, had been defined by their diagnosis. And the negative impact that that had on their ability to live with a high quality of life was just palpable. And I really saw the benefit of exercising and celebrating the abilities that they had left to be able to maximize that independence and make sure that they're able to engage in all of the things that are valuable. And I think a lot of times when somebody is diagnosed with Alzheimer's or dementia, you know, we tend to start looking at them as that diagnosis and all of the things that they're going to lose. And we forget that they have so many more abilities and the opportunity to really continue to celebrate life. And so we're really hoping to give option today on how to best do that. So when words come to mind, what words come to mind when you think of Alzheimer's and dementia? And just shout them out. This is our audience participation part.
Loss.
Loss, okay.
Frustration.
Mm-hmm.
Fear.
Change. Mm-hmm.
Anger.
Absolutely. Are the majority of these thoughts negative or positive?
Negative.
Very negative. And I think that there is such a sense of mourning when somebody is diagnosed with Alzheimer's about everything that's not only going to change for that individual, but their life and all of the individuals that are important to them as a whole. And that is so incredibly challenging. So one of the things that we talk about through our programming is a theory called the theory of retrogenesis. And I know it sounds like a big word, and I feel really smart when I say it. The theory of retrogenesis literally means, all it means, is back to birth, okay? So, not so smart. All right, it concludes that Alzheimer's unravels the brain in almost the exact reverse order as the brain develops from birth. So this principle really helps us to understand how that individual is cognitively functioning at that particular stage. And Naomi's gonna go through some of the staging for us, but we like to say that it creates an aha moment for care partners to really understand where their loved one is functioning. We work through what's called a FAST scale to assign a cognitive level of functioning to that particular individual. And the reason we do it is not to treat people like children, but most of us have had experiences of raising children in some sort of way. And so it really makes sense that if my loved one has a cognitive decline and is functioning at the level of a five-year-old, then I need to adjust my attitudes, my perceptions, and my beliefs to make sure that that individual is supported in the most appropriate way and in a safe way. So as having my five-year-old turned six yesterday, so having a six-year-old now, you know, I know that I need to create opportunities for him to exercise his independence, but doing that in a safe way. He has a ton of abilities, and we're able to celebrate those abilities. And when care partners realize that they can still allow their loved one to be safe and to function and to enjoy life, you know, it takes a huge relief off of them as well. You know, the fact that I allow my child to, you know, pour a cereal or his breakfast in the morning takes a lot of relief off of me as a caregiver for them. And if we're looking at the abilities of individuals with dementia and still allowing them to safely exercise those abilities, it can really minimize the amount of caregiver burnout for people. And so really looking at, okay, this person is still able to do this, so how can I make sure, it might not look like the same way they did it before, but they still might be able to perform that particular activity. And so by looking at the theory of retrogenesis and how we stage the individuals, we talk with the care partners and saying, your loved one is functioning at this level. You know, we have a lot of times, especially in early diagnosis, that our family members really want to see how bad the dementia is. And so they play this 20 questions game with them, which creates a lot of frustration for them, for that loved one, because they can't remember their certain things, and they're never going to be able to get back to that place. And so really throwing those expectations out the window and just being present and being with that particular person and like I said, celebrating those opportunities for them to exercise their ability really helps that person with dementia to be able to perform at every single stage. And that allows us to find joy at every single stage. And Naomi's going to go over some of the different stages in their developmental comparison, and then also some effective care approaches for people functioning at that stage.
Thanks, Shannon. So the early stage of dementia has that developmental age comparison of 4 to 10 years. Some scales will say 4 to 12 years of age. And again, we're only making that developmental age comparison so that you and I as care partners can better understand their best ability to function, okay? These folks will have some new learning potential. Their information processing is such that they can take a piece of new information and apply it to something they've already known in order to transfer that to long-term memory to learn something new. So for example, a new walker. They may fall and now they need a walker. This is a stage where we can still successfully, with some repetition in new learning, introduce that walker and help them be successful in using it. As you'll learn a little bit later on, there comes a point where that new learning potential is no longer there. So it would be silly for me to expect that someone at a more advanced stage of dementia to learn that walker, and then I get frustrated when they don't use it. That is on me as a care partner to adjust my expectations appropriately. But these folks can still have, they still have that new learning potential. These folks are also goal-directed. So that's a really powerful skill that remains for this stage. And what I mean by goal-directed is they recognize the beginning, middle, and end of a task. So if I set them up with the right supplies to brush their teeth and ask them, go ahead and brush your teeth, they can sequence themselves through that task from beginning to end without additional cueing from me. Which, you know, as a care partner, relieves some of that caregiver burden, if you will. They also have the ability to complete simple problem solving. Now, the quality of their problem solving is going to be impaired, so we will need to keep them safe. Like Shannon mentioned, her 6-year-old is going to solve a problem much differently than a 15-year-old would. I worked with a gal once who, I'm going to give you a little demonstration here. She had her walker, and she was trying to get to the other end of the table for bingo. And she got her walker up in between, kind of stuck between these two chairs, and she wasn't going to fit between this pathway, but if she went around, she could get to the other side. So she gets her walker stuck. Now, instead of taking the walker with her around the other way, she just abandoned the walker because it didn't work. It didn't fit. So she could fit, but the walker couldn't. So she just abandoned the walker, went around it, and sat down. That is the quality of problem solving that I'm talking about. Yeah. Say your question again for me.
Can we relate this to early onset Alzheimer's, when people aren't dealing with walkers and things like that?
So you're,
they're dealing with teenagers or young adults, and they're used to, you know, cooking dinner every night and balancing the checkbook and living their very
sure,
active busy
sure.
life. How does that relate to you?
Let me just clarify one thing. Early onset is more the before age 65. Is that what you're talking about? Or are you talking about that mild cognitive impairment?
No, I'm talking
okay.
Early stage.
Sure. The staging is not going to be much different. It's just that you're probably talking about someone who's at a level just a tish higher than this yet, where they're still managing some of those things.
Yeah.
They may need to have the task graded down for them, though. Go ahead.
How does one recognize a parent who is having problems balancing their checkbook, and you believe there may be some cognitive reduction? How do you intervene without creating chaos with mom?
That's kind of the million-dollar question, really. If I had the perfect answer for you, I would be a millionaire, because you would be shocked at how often. It is a challenge. It's very hard, because someone at that stage also is going to have a lot of denial. They're going to have a little bit of insight into understanding that things are changing, and it's not nice. It's not fun to feel that way and to know that. And so there is that that denial piece and that frustration from their end, and it gets to be very difficult to make sure that you are not putting them down, or because that's how they'll feel, is that you're putting me down, you think I can't do this, I've done this for 85 years. It's hard.
One of the things that we suggest oftentimes when those conversations can be really difficult, Dr. Rosenberg talked about the mini cog as being a sixth vital sign, and one of the things that we suggest is that previous to a physician's appointment for your parents or whomever you're concerned about, that you could call that physician anonymously ahead of time and just let them know that you have some concerns, and if they could incorporate that mini cog assessment into their primary care physician appointment, that can be a really successful approach, because it really puts that onus then on that physician to kind of indicate, well, you know, they weren't able to perform that clock exercise appropriately, and you know, there might be a need for further diagnostic testing. So that might be a good way to kind of handle some of those difficult conversations.
So I just did that. I called when I heard about St. Teresa program, I called our doctor. And after begging for a little while, he said, okay, I'll sign you up for someone in our family for memory and cognitive classes would start.
Yeah.
But I went to the physician.
Yep. She just said that she does have experience doing that. She went through the physician to get the resources that she was really needing and grasping for.
And it's just great that physicians are starting to incorporate that into their practice, because it really gives, it really is a step forward that people are recognizing that, you know, memory issues aren't just a normal part of aging. And it is really important that we're starting these conversations. As Anne-Marie mentioned, we partnered with St. Therese to provide mini cog assessments at this most recent state fair, and the amount of individuals that, you know, when approached, indicated, you know, I don't want to know, was just, you know, a huge number. And if we're not looking at these memory issues in real time, you know, some valuable time is lost. And when there are some of those drugs that Dr. Rosenberg, like Aricept, things like that, can be initiated, and they can have an impact, a positive impact. Did you have a question?
I was just going to say, I have to have this conversation with the checkbook tomorrow. so this is helpful. But what I hope to approach it with is, this is going to be a move to protect you and your finances.
Yeah. She said that she has to have the checkbook conversation tomorrow, and she is going to approach it in a way that this is a move to help protect you and your finances. And that's a great strategy as well.
The wonderful thing is St. Teresa will work with your Medicare and your supplement, and they'll take care of it. The insurance is covering it.
Mm-hmm. And we'll talk about that a little bit as we go along here too. So some care, some effective care approaches for someone at this early stage of dementia with that developmental age comparison of 4 to 10 or 12 is set out those supplies, make them visible. They may not be able to go and gather the correct supplies, but if they're set up and they're set out, they can complete that task from beginning to end without further help. Establish and maintain a daily routine. Now this is so critical for these folks at this stage. I just worked with a gentleman through home health who, when we did the cognitive assessments, he tested in this stage, this early stage. And he was more withdrawn, doing a lot of napping, would walk into the kitchen to to get a glass for water and not remember why he was in the kitchen, and he couldn't remember which cupboard the cups were in, and he'd go sit back down. And once we established a routine for him, and not just a routine, but a visual schedule is what we created. He had a wonderful daughter who's a special ed teacher, so she grabbed onto that visual schedule like none other. And we had a whiteboard with his schedule, and as he completed each task each day, he'd move his marker down. It was color-coded, so he had his brain exercise time, and he had his physical exercise time, and he had his paint the birdhouse or a fun activity time, and help put away the dishes. And so it was this very routine day. And about a week after he'd started using this schedule with the help of his family, he was a different guy. He was engaged, he was more verbal, he was enjoying life, because what it did was it took those demands off of his short-term memory, put them on the whiteboard, so he didn't have to try to think about what's next, what do I do, am I supposed to be doing something right now? I don't know. And so he would just withdraw. And it was really neat to see him kind of come out of his shell, and that's exactly what we're talking about here with the Alzheimer's Whisperer program. Is how can we help these folks thrive? Provide assistance for that problem solving. So we need to be that kind of that guide to keep them safe. A gal in one of our facilities lost the cap to her toothpaste tube. Her problem solving ability was to put on the cap, her hairspray cap. Well, she solved it, right? She put the cap on, but it wasn't effective and the toothpaste dried out. So that's the type of problem solving. So we really need to be there as that safety net and make sure these folks are safe. And if it's not a huge critical issue, you know, kind of pick your battles. It's okay. Be flexible. Now the middle stage has that developmental age comparison of 18 months to 3 years. So these folks are going to be very, they're typically going to want to interact with their environment. They're going to want to use their hands. They're busy. But they don't know what they need to be busy with. And a gal I worked with would go and gather all the salt and pepper shakers off of the tables and put them in the top drawer in her room after every single meal. She was very manual. She was in this middle stage. These folks can use their hands, though, and they have the desire to do so. And their brain knows they should be doing something. So we have to find creative ways based on their life story. What did they enjoy? What did she used to do? And how can we incorporate some of those meaningful activities into her daily life in a safe way that allows her to use her hands and to be busy safely and in a way that gives her purpose? These folks also can follow one-step directions with some cueing. They follow one-step directions very well. If you bombard them with a lot of verbal direction, a lot of verbal instruction, they will fall apart. Their brains cannot handle that. So that's a care partner approach that we need to adjust. We have to adjust our approach to best match her cognitive ability. These folks can also notice the cause and effect, the effect that their actions have on an object. So for example, if they're combing their hair in the mirror, you'll see that they notice they maybe missed a spot and they'll adjust to that. Whereas someone who has advanced a little farther will just comb 3 times and stop. And they're not necessarily goal-directed. They didn't finish the task, like in early stage, they're goal-directed. And they're not noticing that they missed the spot to notice that cause and effect action. But these folks still do, which also makes it more easily, it's easier to implement some of those meaningful activities. Some successful care approaches for someone in this middle stage is use familiar objects to maximize their independence. And the reason we want to use familiar objects at this stage is because that new learning potential that I mentioned in the early stage, we don't have that anymore here. So for them to learn to use a new electric toothbrush is only going to inhibit their ability to successfully brush their teeth on their own. So let them use that old red toothbrush with the straight bristles and the pick on the end that they've always loved to use. That will access their procedural memory and allow them to know what to do with it without needing additional help from me. Break the activities down into one-step parts and cue to complete each step. There's a gal named Ruth who she needed us to say, now take the lid off your toothpaste. Now put the toothpaste on your toothbrush. And she'd even say, well, now what? Now what? She was cueing the care partner to give her that next step, because she needed that next step cue to know what to do. So that will be a really important care approach. If I just set Ruth up, who's in this middle stage, with her supplies and say, Ruth, brush your teeth, and then I come back in 10 minutes and I'm frustrated because she didn't brush her teeth, that was an effective care approach on my part because I did not give Ruth the opportunity to use her best ability, which is to complete the task with one-step direction. Visual, verbal, and tactile cues are important. Verbal cue is exactly that, sit down. A tactile cue is a touch cue. Not hand over hand doing it for them, but a touch cue, where you might tap their leg if you need the right leg to move. Move this leg, that's a touch cue. And a visual cue is maybe a demonstration, where if you want them to sit down, you show them, sit down. Pairing those three for the same direction will allow them the best chance to process what you want them to do. The late stage is a developmental age comparison of 12 to 18 months. Now these folks still have the ability to communicate, but it has become much more simplified. So because of that, you and I as care partners need to simplify our language that we give to them. They are going to best respond to your nonverbal message, how you're saying something, rather than necessarily what you're saying. Same with the end stage. They have the gross motor movement maybe yet to sit and stand and walk, as long as there's no other comorbidity that has prevented that. You know, if someone has a stroke and hemiparesis, obviously that's not what we're talking about here, but if we're strictly talking dementia and the cognitive change, these folks can still sit, stand, and walk because they can still move their body against gravity with postural actions. They have the use of their hands, and they may self-feed very well if we introduce finger foods. When you think about the theory of retrogenesis, the first abilities that we acquire as humans are the last to leave us as we progress through dementia. So what does that mean when it comes to self-feeding? Here's a question for you. This little one in my belly here, can he or she bring his hand to his mouth? Yes. So that would be a first ability we acquire as a human. So that hand-to-mouth action is very, very ingrained in us. Now, is there a spoon in my womb? I hope not. I hope we don't get any surprises in November. But the ability to use the spoon and to recognize what that spoon means is going to diminish. So how can they still be successful? Self-feed with finger foods. If we allow these folks to feed themselves, or anyone, if you feed yourself, you are 30% less likely to aspirate. Aspirate means food went into your lungs. So it is really critical that we use that kind of a care approach. How can they best function? Some really other, some other effective care approaches are allowing processing time and wait for a response. I'm gonna make you all uncomfortable now. I worked with a gal named Alice, and I would go up to Alice, and I would make eye contact, and she was just this little lady in this tiny wheelchair, so I'd get down to her level, and I would say, "Hi, Alice." "Hi," she'd say back. After 7 seconds, if I was in a hurry, I didn't allow her the wait time, I would not have allowed her to use her best ability to communicate back to me. And then we could interact. It was like that kickstart that her brain needed. So that wait time just becomes so important. How many of you were uncomfortable during that wait time? When is she gonna talk again? Like, what is she doing? Did she forget what she was gonna say? Oh my gosh, I'm nervous for her. Right? You think all those things. But the wait time is so critical to allow them that time to formulate what it, what their message, their intended message is. Eliminate distractions. These are internal distractions, these are external distractions. What I mean by internal distractions are, I need to use the bathroom. My back hurts. I got that blister on my foot. Ugh. You're distracted by something internally, something going on in your body. Pain, hunger, thirst. So we need to meet those needs first before we expect them to complete or perform some other function, like eating at a meal, or even using the bathroom. If they're distracted by something else, they may not even void, even if they're sitting on the toilet, but they're distracted by something, they may not be able to void. Because at this point, they're processing, their best ability to process is one thing at a time. Ensure, the external distractions then are things like going on around you. The buzz of the fan, watching kids play outside. The TV and the radio are both on when you're trying to help them get dressed. Well, that's not a good care approach because we're putting too many demands on their cognition. We're making them rule out the TV and eliminate the radio and only focus on what I'm doing, but they can't do that. So we have to be that filter to filter out those distractions for them. These folks also benefit if their feet are firmly planted on a surface because of their proprioception and their proprioceptive input has changed, and they may kind of feel that they're not secure and safe if those feet are not planted. And then give those verbal, visual, and tactile cues. End stage has the developmental age comparison of an infant. These folks you may see, they're not gonna be able to move their body through space posturally anymore, but they can still move. And so they have those reflexive movements. And if we tap into the correct sensory stimulation for them, we can see them use those movements that they have. So they can still respond to sensory stimulation when it's meaningful. They're able to smile and vocalize, and they can still engage with you. They can feel and express love. They will understand how you say something versus what you say. Soft, gentle touch, or some folks like more of a deep touch, can be so powerful. If you think about how much we touch and hold and snuggle an infant, it's the same at the end of life, and we kind of forget that. How we don't touch them, we don't give them that sense of security like we maybe could. Providing meaningful sensory stimuli to these folks is very powerful. Two interventions that I found to be really successful are music and smell. And it has to do with the way that those two things are processed through our brains. They are tied to our emotions, and so if, I'll give you an example. Something that's meaningful to me would be, I grew up on a farm in North Dakota, and we had this huge lawn to mow. And so we were always having to mow the lawn, always. Like once you'd get done, you started over, you know, one of those lawns. So our lawn always smelled like fresh cut grass. And that smell of fresh cut grass, to me, still, when I smell it going for a walk through the neighborhood, it takes me back to the farm. And it takes me back to that warm, fuzzy, that was security, that was home, that was safety, that was love. So smell can be a very powerful tool. If you know what's meaningful to them, how could you tie a smell to it to help them feel that security and that safety? Use their name. Use their name often. We have all been whoever you are since birth. Your name has been with you. It's the most meaningful word at this point because it's been with us the longest. So lead with their name. There's a point where they're no longer going to recognize themselves as mom or dad, but they will recognize themselves as Naomi or Shannon. So it makes more sense to go, if you go visit one of, you know, your parent, and rather than saying, "Hi Dad, I'm here to see you," and he's kind of confused, and, "Dad, don't you remember me?" Well, he doesn't, and if you highlight that, all it's going to do is stir frustration and agitation for him. So rather you can say, "Hi Bill, it's great to see you today, I love that shirt," and it's going to be hard for you as a care partner, because you may have to, you may go through those stages of grief. It's like losing a loved one in a way. Even though he's still physically there, it feels like he's not. But what is best for him is for you to just emulate positivity, let him be Bill instead of Dad, and engage in some sort of a meaningful task from his childhood or early adulthood, and you might see this whole different side of Bill and have a really positive and pleasurable experience together. Provide the stimuli right in front of them, especially this stage and the late stage. The visual field will kind of shrink. And so we're looking at about 12 to 18 inches at the most, 12 to 14 inches. And be mindful of that verbal and nonverbal message that you're sending. It's really not about what you say, but how you say it at this point.
So you can see how these effective care approaches really shift the focus onto us and how we need to adapt and adjust our attitudes and perceptions and our expectations to meet that individual's needs. It can kind of, you know, completely shift how our relationship was with that individual for our whole entire life. And as Naomi mentioned, that can be a huge transition for the care partners, and it can be really, really challenging. But if you are able to really look and incorporate some of these approaches, you know, it really kind of celebrates all of that time that you have still left with them, even though it does look different. You know, I mean, being able to hear a story from your loved one that maybe you were never aware of before can be a whole opportunity to connect with that individual in a totally different situation than you ever would have expected. You know, infants bring so much joy. If there was an infant that came into this room right now, I mean, immediately the energy would be focused onto that, to that young child. And we all know, you know, the very difficult situations. We've heard it in the media when a child hasn't got that touch and that love right off the bat, and how that can kind of change the whole trajectory of that individual's life. And to be able to be there and to be present with your loved one at all of those types of stages is just incredibly critical. And that's how we can truly thrive and not just survive. So it really is a matter of shifting our paradigm, how we view memory issues. You know, I equate a lot of times memory issues and talking about it to how we reacted to the breast cancer movement in the early 80s. You know, people were just not comfortable in having the discussion about, you know, needing to go and get mammograms, needing to talk to their family about their concerns. And what happened was a lot of individuals lost their lives because they didn't get the intervention at the right time. And so we really need to start talking about these issues and having these itchy, scratchy conversations with our family members. And I think one of the biggest ways to be able to do that is to start planning very early on, before memory loss is even, you know, at the forefront. So just as we would plan for advanced directives, we really need to start communicating to our families, not just end of life decisions, but what's important while I'm still living and how I want things to really play out. You know, and some of that, as Naomi mentioned, the importance of schedules, especially the individuals that are not living with their loved one with Alzheimer's or dementia. You know, as a daughter, I have no idea, you know, anymore what my parents' routine is. You know, I know to a certain extent that they go to church every Sunday, that they're very active in their community, that they, you know, love camping, all of these types of things. But if you were to ask me what routines they had every day, you know, especially now that they're retired, I have absolutely no idea. And so being able to help to understand, okay, you know, what do you do? What time do you usually get up? What time do you usually take a shower? We worked with one individual down, and I run an office down in Fairmont, Minnesota. And we worked with an individual in the assisted living there that was having significant issues. He was in jeopardy of being kicked out because he had so many significant behaviors around showering. And the staff was pretty much at a crisis point, and the family was too. They're like, what am I going to do with my loved one? If they, you know, there's not a lot of options down there. I certainly can't take care of them at home. And so they asked us to come in and help to work with the staff and really talk you know, the family and try to figure out how we can make sure that not only him, but other individuals are safe during this activity of showering. Because showering can be one of the most challenging tasks to perform for a caregiver, and a lot of injuries not only happen to that client or to that particular patient or individual, but also to the loved ones. And so one of the very first things that we do is try to get to know that individual's life story. You know, who are they? What was their profession? What's important to them? What's the family dynamic look like? What year did they grow up? You know, were they rich? Were they poor? All of those kind of things are really good clues as to how we can effectively look at the whole picture of that individual. And so in conducting that interview, it determined that that gentleman was a farmer. And so I said, well, when are you bathing, or when are you trying to get him in the shower? Well, when? In the morning. So, well, let's try to move that shower to the evening time. You know, he was a farmer. He'd spend his whole days out on the farm getting dirty, you know, coming home stinking like manure. And before he crawled into bed with his wife, he wanted to make sure that he was clean. And so we transitioned that shower into the evening time. Was it an adjustment for the staff? Absolutely. Was it an adjustment for, you know, the staffing ratios and all of the other, you know, pieces that they had to get done and to accomplish? Absolutely, but it was something that was going to improve that individual's quality of life and thus improve all of the interactions, not only for other residents, but for you know, the family. All of those types of attitudes really, just in that one thing, really were adjusted, and he almost completely eradicated the behaviors. So that's why it's so important to understand that schedule. And also about you know, medications. You know, we think that we know all of the medications that mom and dad might be taking or your spouse might be taking, but over-the-counter medications can often be overlooked. You might have a loved one that has arthritis, and they've just popped a Tylenol arthritis medicine for the last 5 years, and that's really mitigated a lot of their pain. Well, now they're transitioning either to live with you or into an assisted living, and what got overlooked? That pain medication. And so they're reacting to, okay, well, now Mrs. Jones, we need to get up and we need to go into the cafeteria. And I'm an aide and I help her up and I get smacked. She hasn't been taking her pain medication, you know, even though it is out over the counter. So those kind of things and that proactive approach is really how we can start shifting the paradigm. And also as Dr. Rosenberg mentioned the whole mini-cog assessments as well. You know, you might see your doctor start to incorporate that at the, over the age of 65, and that really gives you a running tally on how you're functioning from year to year. And that can be incredibly valuable and help to facilitate conversation over memory changes. So all of those things are incredibly exciting. So one of the biggest paradigm shifts too, I think, that needs to happen is where we can live appropriately with having dementia and Alzheimer's. You know, I think a lot of times, and maybe you've been there, your a loved one's diagnosed, and the first thing you think about was, okay, housing. Where am I gonna? Where are they gonna live? Because I don't know if it's an option to be able to care for them appropriately at my house, or if they are able to live at home. There is still a lot of opportunity when you incorporate some of these effective care approaches to keep your loved one at home until end. But it really needs to be about people being empowered about what to expect and getting the help at the right time. As being in home care, we get so many calls of individuals at crisis. I mean, it's just absolutely heartbreaking. You know, it is a matter of, you know, I'm at my wit's end and I'm going to have to place my mom. I tried so hard to care for her at my house, and I've had to adjust all of my life, my quality of life, everything to be able to accomplish this. But there is still opportunity to help at home. And that's one of the things that Naomi and I and our organizations, HealthStar and St. Therese, really are just so honored to be able to provide that support through a program that we call Becoming an Alzheimer's Whisperer. I'll talk a little bit more down the road about just kind of insurance funding. I know that can be a really difficult thing for a lot of people to navigate, so we'll talk a little bit more about that. But the Becoming an Alzheimer's Whisperer really will teach a lot of the things that we're talking about and put them into practice in situations that's going to be applicable for your life situation and your loved one. And so, like we talked about, getting to know that individual, getting to know and understanding that person's life journey, what's important to them, you know, how are they going to be able to maximize the abilities that they have with or remaining, and in a structured, individualized plan. And one of those ways to do that is incorporating different therapies into being able to support that person at home.
Yeah, the interventions that we can incorporate into the home are a multidisciplinary approach. So we're talking about nurses, physical therapists, occupational therapists, speech language pathologists or speech therapists, social workers. Kind of everybody plays this critical role in identifying what care approaches need to be incorporated into this particular situation. Therapy services are not just for broken bones. You know, I am a therapist, and we're trained to fix. We are trained to rehabilitate. We're trained to get them back, fix them. But there's a whole nother side of therapy that is a habilitative approach, not rehabilitative. And that habilitative approach to therapy allows us to assess that person cognitively, assess that person physically, assess the environment, what adaptations are maybe already in place, what adaptations maybe need to be in place, and take this whole picture of your loved one's life story and all their remaining abilities and combine that into a very tangible plan for you as a care partner on how to help them thrive and how to help them stay at home. And we will help you, you know, okay, so they're having this behavior around such and such, and we can do some behavioral analysis and behavior modification plans to kind of determine the pattern. What's the pattern with that behavior? Why is it happening? Behavior is oftentimes a form of communication. It's not a behavior. It is how they're able to communicate with us. So we need to dig deeper and figure out what are they trying to communicate? And how am I as a care partner maybe needing to adapt in order to relieve and get rid of that behavior so they don't feel that they need to communicate whatever it is they're trying to communicate to us? How can we meet that need? So the therapists have multiple assessments, standardized assessment tools at our fingertips that help us determine what stage of the disease process is your loved one in. We talked about those stages. So based on skilled observation and some multiple administrations of various standardized tests, we can help you determine where are their best abilities. It really takes us as care partners to be creative I love working with my occupational therapist because I think those are some of the most creative people on the face of this earth. They come up with some of the neatest interventions, and me as the black and white in the box speech therapist thinker, I'm just like, wow, that was really insightful. I wouldn't have thought of that. So that's why we really need that team. Creativity is huge. Thinking outside the box with dementia care is crucial. Patience. It might take some trial and error. Let's try this. It didn't work. Let's try this. Still didn't work. Let's try this. It didn't work. But you never know when you're going to find that thing that worked. Flexibility is really big. Like I kind of talked about picking your battles. It's okay if it's different. As long as they're safe and they can be happy, it's okay if it's different. And let's be flexible about, you know, what's worth trying to fix here and what's maybe it's okay that it's that way. And be persistent. I worked with a gal named Vivian. And Vivian had a lot of behaviors around toileting. And it took a lot of persistence from everyone's part, including her family, to figure out why toileting was so hard. What made toileting so tough? To find out, and it was strictly by the grace of God we found this out, because I don't know how else, I still don't know how we figured this out, but Vivian grew up in the Depression and only wanted 2 squares of toilet paper. And these care partners that were working with her were just taking the toilet paper for her and in a big old clump in a ball, and it's wasteful, and there was too much of it. And she would hit them and yell at them and call them names, and that was her way, that was her best ability to communicate them to them that this isn't right, this isn't right, this isn't right. And we figured out to give her 2 squares of toilet paper. Let her do it herself. She would fold them so neatly, and the behaviors were gone. That took persistence to figure that out. We tried all kinds of care approaches before that. Didn't work, but we found the one that did.
And we always say, when you're frustrated, just remember, two squares. Just say it over again, and you know, it might be something that is not staring you right at the, you know, in the face. I mean, it could be something like totally off, you know, in left wing, but if it works, it's great. I mean, you know, there's so many ways to accomplish a certain task, and it might look different, you know, to everybody. So just having that flexibility is just absolutely critical. I think one of the things that I hear a lot too, you know, in new diagnosis and just, I mean, just in planning for life in general, is just the really difficult time that it is navigating the insurance aspect of things. You know, I'm in healthcare and it is incredibly complicated, and just when I think I got it figured out, they go ahead and change something again. And so I really empathize with individuals that even don't have that background. And then, you know, put on top of that just an immense amount of stress and you know, just from caregiving in general. And it becomes like, you know, analysis paralysis. You don't know where to, you know, and when to make the next step. So we're going to kind of go through a little bit of that insurance piece. But also, like, who can be referred to this particular program that we're talking about, the Becoming an Alzheimer's Whisperer program? And I don't know if we have individuals here that are looking for resources more nationally. Maybe you have a family member that's out of state, and they are just really hoping to try to get, you know, some support. This program called Becoming an Alzheimer's Whisperer was something that HealthStar partnered with an organization called CNV, Senior Care Specialists. And the organization I work for, HealthStar, we really look at how we can provide services to individuals that are underserved, and really determining that individuals being able to find support in a home type setting or an assisted living type setting was not happening very often. And so we really sought out to look at partnering with an organization to be able to develop a structured, evidence-based programming to be able to deliver through various payer sources. And that led us to the Senior CNV Specialist. It is an organization, it's two women, it's Dr. Verna Carson and also Kathleen Vandenhorst. And they are both nurses. Dr. Carson is a a doctorate of psychiatric nursing, and really looked at how to develop this program in a way that was going to be simple. And she looked was astute in trying to figure out, you know, how can we create that aha moment? And that led her to the theory of retrogenesis and this individual by the name of Barry Griesberg that created the program. And so she developed these interventions on how we could assess that individual for a cognitive level of functioning and look at the whole picture. And so they developed a number of different tools for us as an organization to utilize and called care manuals that we can go into a home and really work with that loved one and their care partners. Their organization works throughout the nation. Typically, they only partner with one company throughout the state. And so you can visit their website if you're looking for more national resources. And there's also another care partner that we have by the name of Lori LeBay. And she has an organization called AlzheimerSpeaks.com, and she has just a plethora of information there. She really has this hopeful approach as well. She took care of her mom for over 30 years with Alzheimer's. And so it became her real life mission to be able to connect people with resources. And we talk about that being flexible piece, and she, you know, and about picking your battles. And Lori will tell you that by the end stage of her mom had terrible, terrible aggression around wanting to brush her teeth. And apparently her mom had one of the most beautiful smiles and was really known for this. But she had just this huge amount of frustration. And Lori said, you know what? It's not worth it. It's not worth the aggression that my mom feels, you know, to try to get this particular task performed. And she said by end of life that her mom's teeth looked like, she said, a rusty chainsaw with fried rice. And she said, it was okay. It wasn't okay for everybody else. Everybody else really had a difficult time with that. But Lori knew in her heart of hearts that this was what was best for mom. And she threw all expectations out the window. And that's something that we would really want to encourage you guys to do as well. And remember that flexibility in two squares. So a person that has that newly diagnosed with it, where a person's family needs support in understanding that disease process, that knowledge is so powerful. I mean, it, just being able to like have that knowledge of the theory of retrogenesis, I hope kind of has planted a little seed for you guys today that you'll kind of understand that it is about that adjustment. So understanding that disease process and then tools for managing the system. A lot of what we talked about today is something that we would do and work through with you guys in theory in the actual living environment. That's why I absolutely love home care. I just fell in love with home care right away because we have an opportunity, the clinicians have an opportunity to really understand what is truly going on with that individual in their home environment. You know, in a clinical setting, you know, you have the individual that might be saying, oh yeah, you know, I have no idea why my blood sugars are 500. I'm doing everything I need to do. And you go to the home and they have a cabinet delegated just for Oreo cookies. So, you know, those kind of things, we get to be able to put those pieces of the puzzle together. And as Naomi mentioned, you know, the role of therapy and an occupational therapist, you know, being able to keep somebody in home and independent longer, occupational therapists are just awesome at being able to look at the whole picture and say, oh, opportunity to maximize independence here, opportunity to maximize independence there. And in a home setting that's applicable for that person. So when Naomi went through the stages, you know, you see a pretty big range of the different stages, and everybody can kind of transition at a different period of time. And sometimes that transition elicits a new issue that might need to be resolved. And so a person transitioning into a new stage can absolutely be an opportunity to initiate these services. A person who is experiencing difficulties in communicating or difficulties swallowing, that's when my friend Naomi can come out as a speech and language pathologist in a lot of different ways for that communication to be able to work with that loved one. A person experiencing changes in balance or their mobility. We have a PT here from St. Therese as well, and this is a great opportunity for physical therapy to be involved and for them to really teach and educate that primary caregiver on how to be more effective and make sure that we're still not, you know, just because it's difficult to get up from the chair, that, you know, we're still getting up and being able to keep going as long as possible. So a person whose sleep patterns are disrupted, I think a lot of people hear about sundowning, et cetera. If you think about going back to the theory of retrogenesis, you know, my child's a little beyond nap age now, but I know Naomi has a little one that I'm sure, you know, by the time you get to 3 o'clock at night, or at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, he's tired. And so what happens is he starts getting a little ornery. You know, I mean, some of those external triggers, you know, being hungry, call that hangry at our house. When you get really, you know, frustrated and hungry, and then it elicits a behavior. So if you do have a need for services, what's the next step? So that insurance verification, a lot of people don't know that Medicare will pay for this type of service to be delivered in home. And the reason a lot of people don't know that is individuals with Alzheimer's weren't always able to partake in this benefit. And the Alzheimer's Association successfully sued CMS in the early 2000s for denying home care claims for individuals with essentially the same care plan if they had a different diagnosis, so say Parkinson's. They would deny the claim for Alzheimer's, but not the claim for Parkinson's. And the thought process is that Medicare really is supposed to pay for that individual to be rehabilitated. And they said, Medicare said, well, an individual with Alzheimer's isn't able to be capable of learning new things, so there's no way that they're going to be able to be rehabilitated, so they don't get to partake in this. Well, they were successful with that, with suing them. And so now we're able to provide the service through Medicare Part A, which is a wonderful, wonderful opportunity for people. There's a couple stipulations for that. That individual would need to meet what's called a homebound criteria, okay? And that is that it would take a reasonable and exhausting effort for that individual to leave their home, and they would need the support of another to be able to do so. So it's really brave when it comes to cognitive abilities, because physically I might be able to get out of my house, but I might not cognitively be able to be safe there. And so it's our responsibility as a home care agency to determine whether or not that homebound status is being met, okay? And then the clinician is responsible for doing that, but the physician is responsible for also saying, yep, you're right. So we work with a physician to certify that homebound status and provided they're willing to do that, and provided that they're willing to have what's called a face-to-face encounter. So Medicare has all these rules, and one of the rules is that they need for a patient to be with, to see their physician either 90 days prior to the day that we call the start of care, so the day that we're out there, or 30 days after. And they need to then certify, yep, I've seen this person, and yep, they are homebound. So those things need to be in place, but those are all things that we as an organization help to work with the families to understand and make sure that those things are accomplished. So after that, a clinician will come out to the home, and that typically starts with a registered nurse who's been trained in this programming. And they will go out and they will do quite a few assessments, because we're required for those assessments. And so the first couple visits are really a lot about assessments and fact-finding. And so we'll send over what's called the plan of care over to the physician, and what we need the physician to do is just to look through it and say, this is an okay plan, and you as clinicians can deliver this in a home setting. So we're essentially taking the clinic and putting it in the home. And again, that's something that we really work to get that taken care of all on the back end. So once that approval is received for being able to go out there, then that assessment will have been completed. And then the services will start. And so we'll look at being out there for, typically we'll set goals with the family involvement and with that patient's involvement whenever possible. And then we have 60 days to accomplish those goals, okay? And they might be met after 30 days, okay? And we might say, oh, you know what? You guys are doing well, we've set up for success, people are feeling like things are going great, and so then we'll do a discharge, and then we'll say, you know, if things change, call us back again, we can come out again, okay, for like a new behavior, etc. It might take 60 days, and maybe at the end of the 60 days, there's still a need. Maybe PT has not been able to get that person's strength up. You know, maybe there's still a swallowing issue, those types of things, so then we'll start what's called another 60-day episode. And so we can continue to do that where it's reasonable for, you know, as long as that progress is happening. And so it kind of looks different just for every, you know, as individual as that the person is. So So we, you know, that's a little bit about how our programming, you know, can help to support, but really we're hoping to have really armed you with some really great knowledge in that you can apply to either your direct life or help to educate other individuals.